talking about an infectious disease outbreak that impacts many people in many countries. But in terms of how many people, how many countries, what we saw with COVID-19, so the moment where it got defined as a pandemic, I mean, that was largely a judgment call. It's not like there was a specific number of people we're looking for and then alarms go off and it's now a pandemic. So yeah, it's more defined in general terms.
One of the questions on my first year exam is always, what's the difference between an epidemic and a pandemic? And what I expect them to say is about the global reach, that it's about, because I'm also teaching about globalization, and that one thing that, whether we're talking about the Spanish flu or whether we're talking about COVID, it's the movement and travel of people that spread the disease, and it's in more than one place. So if we think about pre-industrial societies, the reason why a lot of epidemics were confined and then kind of ran themselves out, they ran through all the people, I'm thinking especially of Ebola, it's because there wasn't those transports. So to me, a pandemic, it's definitely more than one country, it's global, but it's also about modernization, it's also about multiple countries and spread and movement.
I think that the more broad picture here is that we have these moments of historical amnesia. This is the worst it's ever been because of this and this and this. And maybe it's the infection rate, or maybe it's the death rate, or maybe it's, you know, the travel restrictions because we travel more today. But there's a desire, almost like a hubris, that, you know, each time we face one of these things, it's the worst. And then try to explain why that is. And it seems to sometimes, I think, change the narrative or change the conversation and perhaps even confuse us in terms of directing energies towards addressing certain issues. And when we take a step back, I think what we can see is that actually each time there are a lot of commonalities, but the prioritization in terms of how to actually address things gets kind of confused in that moment of panic and fear, where, you know, where are the origins of the spread? Who is to blame? Who's going to build a vaccine? Is it something that can be addressed with a vaccine? Big scientific questions, big historical questions are not something that can be answered by one set of expertise even, or authority. We desperately need these sort of interdisciplinary and different ways of thinking approaches in order to both understand the causes and outcomes, but also to explain them.
Try to imagine an aspect of our life that hasn't been affected by this pandemic. I mean, obviously you need all of those voices guiding you to what's the most appropriate way to respond. And that's the challenge. I mean, you're always making decisions based on incomplete information. You know, was it a good idea to shut down the school? Should we have done this? I mean, you sort of take your best guess and see what happens from there. And to appreciate as well that there's no sort of right or wrong answer. It's all a trade-off. You know, if we do this in the interest of safety, that's going to have consequences in terms of the economy. And I think that's the problem, that everybody thinks there's just this sort of, you know, simple binary approach to it. And it's much more complicated than that. In terms of tools that we've had to be able to respond to the pandemic, we're not that much different from 1918. I mean, we had to rely on old school methodologies, and you need people to understand that, and you need people to embrace that. And at the same time, when you read through the literature of what was happening in 1918, of, you know, the anti-maskers and all of that, and you look at their literature then versus, you know, 100 years later, and it's the same damn arguments.
We like to study the other. We don't study ourselves. And this disease is mostly affected to a large extent, at least up until recently, the Western world. It's been seen as a kind of Western disease. So what I think we should use that model. I think we need to say to people, what are the questions that you can answer? And then to say, read each other's articles, write them in forms that people can read. And that's what they did with the Ebola virus right from the beginning. And they were changing things as people were doing this research. They were changing the way they approached. They were changing the color of the PPE they were wearing, because what was culturally appropriate. And I think we see the other as, okay, let's go study the other and let's figure it out. Whereas we don't necessarily do that with ourselves, but I think we should.
Figuring out the science relative to figuring out people, the science is the easy part.
And it works both ways. Like, I think the humanities could, you know, we have a lot to learn from the science as well, instead of cleaving into our disciplinary silos.
We've moved away from a society where our primary focus is the group and the whole. to a society where we're so individualized that the discourse around not wearing a mask, the discourse around not socially distancing or staying in your houses has been very much, you can't tell me what to do. As opposed to what public health thinks it can do is tell people what the good of society is. And so we've changed the way, you know, we've become a very individualistic society, and we see our individual rights as paramount as opposed to group rights. And I don't know that one is necessarily better than the other.
I think it's also as people assign themselves to different groups and the group responds in a certain way. So I have to respond in a similar way to be a part of that group. And, you know, all of their beliefs and answers kind of go part and parcel with that. I mean, I think it's important to not to focus too much on the negatives of what's been happening.
The physical connection, the being in the same space, I really never appreciated as much as I do now. And the other thing I realized is you have to have a pet because you can't get through this without.
I would have considered myself a bit of an introvert and a bit of a hermit, that I didn't need a lot of social interaction or being around people. I now appreciate that's not true. You know, to be in a lecture theater again, you know, filled with students, I think I'll probably cry the first time giving an actual lecture again. But this has also really restored my faith in humanity and my faith in the scientific profession, that we were part of twice a week in these early morning calls with the WHO, where all the scientists from around the world who were working on vaccines would call in. And everybody was so free with their ideas, their data, offering advice to others. You know, you need this reagent, it's on its way.
I'm quite fascinated by like what mark this pandemic is going to leave on the way that we interact with each other. Will there be, you know, will there be less air travel? Will we care about each other in new and different ways? What will the kids remember from this period? And what sort of marks of compassion as well as caution are they going to carry with them?